Hello friends, welcome back. So in the last lecture we saw basic anatomy of the orbit along with the compartmental anatomy, and today I'm going to discuss the first compartment, that is the globe. So again, revising from the last lecture, we have different compartments of the orbit. Coming to the globe, the globe is further divided by the lens into aqueous humor anteriorly, and posteriorly we have the vitreous humor. Then second comes the optic nerve and the optic nerve sheath. Third compartment is the conal and the intraconal. Conal is formed by the muscle cone, and inside that we have the intraconal compartment, and lastly is the extraconal compartment, which is located between the muscle cone and the bony ovoidal wall. Coming to the post contrast image of the globe, so remember, in the globe only the choroid of the globe will enhance, which is the vascular part, and the black line which is seen is the sclera, it never enhances. So globe pathologies, I have divided them into children, adults, or common in both. In children, we see various congenital anomalies like aplasia or hypoplasia, bioophthalmos, colobomas, persistent hyperplastic primary vitreous, Coats disease, choroidal hemangioma or retinoblastoma. Whereas in the adults, we have choroidal melanoma and metastasis, which are seen exclusively in adults. Common to both includes vitreous hemorrhage, retinal or choroidal detachments, foreign body, orbital pseudotumor, and thysis bulbi. So, this child had an ophthalmia, that is, there is complete absence of the globe as well as the optic nerves. Now, these are the extraocular muscles which are seen. So again, this is the coronal T2-weighted image. We see complete absence of optic chiasm. So this is an ophthalmia, that is absence of globe along with absence of optic nerves and optic chiasm. This is a 5-day-old child with history of seizures. So here we see the globe is present, however it is small in size, therefore this is microophthalmia. Along with that, there is associated defect along the post-optic nerve head associated with a large retrobulbar cystic lesion. So this is coloboma. The lens is also appears abnormal here. Associated lot of intracranial abnormalities are seen, that is a posterior fossa is enlarged, associated with some arachnoid cyst. The cerebellum is small, appears dysplastic, better seen on the sagittal images. Then there is complete absence of corpus callosum, multiple presence of choroid plexus cyst. These are grey matter heterotropia which are seen in the periventricular region on both the sides, along the left frontal horn as well as along the occipital horn on the right side. So these constellation of findings are seen in Aicardi syndrome. So what is Aicardi syndrome? Again, to revise, we have microophthalmia associated with coloboma. Then we have dysplastic cerebellum along with posterior fossa cyst, choroid plexus cyst, absence of corpus callosum agenesis, and subependymal heterotropia. So this is a case of microophthalmia and coloboma. So why do we get coloboma? It's basically because of incomplete closure of embryonic fissure. And colobomas with microophthalmia is associated with various syndromes. One is Aicardi syndrome, Chart syndrome, and Meckel syndrome. Now, this is a 12-year-old male with family history of NF1. So this child has large orbits or the large globes. So this is basically bioophthalmos, which is actually enlargement of the globe along with raised intraocular pressure. It can be primary or it can be secondary to Sturge-Weber syndrome, NF1 like in this patient, globe tumors, uveal pathology, or can be seen in high myopia. This child also had abnormal white matter signal in bilateral globus pallidi, which is classically seen in NF1. Now, coming to globe tumors, retinoblastoma is the most common tumor in children. The classic finding is calcification, classic finding is a mass in the intraocular mass along with calcification, and clinically it gives rise to leukochorea in a child. So the retinoblastoma can be unilateral as seen here, or it can be bilateral seen here. Here also we see there is extension of the tumor in the retrobulbar region in the intraconal space. Now this is the MRI of a child, 1.5-year-old child with leukochorea. So again we see a heterogeneous mass which is located in the orbit. There is associated retinal detachment, V-shaped retina. And there is some heterogeneous enhancement of the mass. SWI is important to pick up calcification. However, CT demonstrates calcification much better. So retinoblastoma, it's the most common intraocular tumor in childhood. 60% are sporadic and 40% are hereditary, associated with osteosarcoma and cutaneous melanoma. Retinoblastoma, as I mentioned, can be unilateral, can be bilateral in almost 25% of the patients. It can be trilateral when it is seen in both the globes along with pineal gland or supracellar region, or quadrilateral when pineal as well as supracellar both are involved. So infiltration of optic nerve or choroid infiltration are important predictors of metastasis. Coming to the various DDs of leukochorea, so this is a 5-year-old child who had these findings. That is, there was a calcifying lesion located in the right orbit, and basically this is actually Coats disease. So what is it? It is characterized by telangiectatic leaky retinal vessels which result in exudative retinal detachment. Most of the time there will be no calcification, however sometimes the calcification can be seen, like in our case. However, important point to differentiate is that there is lack of enhancing mass which is seen in retinoblastoma. So how do we differentiate retinoblastoma with Coats disease? Retinoblastoma usually is seen in less than 5 years, whereas Coats disease is seen in 6 to 8 years. Calcification is almost seen in 95% of retinoblastoma, whereas with Coats disease it's usually rare. Also, there is diffuse increase in globe attenuation. So Coats disease, we saw retinal detachment, or it is linear shaped retinal detachment or V shaped retinal detachment. However, retinoblastoma will be mass like, and signal intensity of retinoblastoma will be T1 hyper, T2 hypo, and because of calcification everything appears heterogeneous. As compared to Coats disease, there will be presence of hemorrhage and fibrosis, and hence it will have more of heterogeneous appearance. Also, the globe volume will be usually small in Coats disease. Okay, coming to next differential for leukochorea. So this is classic persistent hypoplastic primary vitreous. That is, there is failure of the primary vitreous to undergo regression during the development of the eye. So what are the radiological findings here? We have the lens which is anteriorly displaced. There is a retrolenter opacity which can enhance, and it extends into the Cloquet's canal, giving rise to the triangular appearance of the mass. It may be associated with retinal detachment. There will be presence of vitreous hemorrhage, and usually the globe is small as compared to the opposite side. So this is classic persistent hyperplastic primary vitreous. Think about when you see a retrolenteral opacity with a triangular appearance of the with a triangular shape to the mass, then think of PHPV. Other differential for leukochorea are retinopathy of prematurity. Usually the history of preterm birth with oxygen supplementation is present. It is characterized by small disorganized eye with retinal detachments and intraocular hemorrhage. There may be presence of calcification, and in long standing cases it will result in thysis bulbi. Then other differential diagnosis for leukochorea include toxocariasis and sclerosing endophthalmitis. Usually when we have sclerosing endophthalmitis, all the layers of the globe will be involved and they'll be showing enhancement, and there may be associated granulomatous mass in the retina. and however these are difficult to differentiate only on imaging and you need other serological examinations. Now this is a 40-year-old male who had history of high myopia. So what do we see here? We see enlargement of the globe. So basically it's more of elongation of the globe. This is classic for stephyloma. So it is characterized by thinning and stretching of the uveoscleral cords of the eyeball. Progressive myopia usually results in posterior stephyloma like we see here, or it can also be seen secondary to glaucoma, scleritis, trauma, post-infection, post-surgery or post-radiotherapy. This is a patient, 41-year-old male, who had acute onset of blurring of the vision. So what do we see here? We see a radio-opaque foreign body which is located in the inferior aspect of the vitreous humor. So this is classic for foreign body. Remember, for foreign body, MRI is contraindicated because metallic foreign body can, under the influence of magnetic field, can cause damage to the globe and brain further. This is a 70-year-old male who had history of trauma following which he had vision loss. So we have T2 sagittal weighted images, coronal and the axial images. So what do we see here? The lens is displaced superiorly. No, this is the normal position of the lens here. So here the lens is displaced superiorly and posteriorly into the vitreous humor. This I have shown for comparison where the normal lens of the left eye is located. So this is traumatic dislocation of the lens. Coming to the next case, this is a 75-year-old male who had reduction in right eye since 2 months. So here we see V-shaped membrane. So V-shaped retina, when we see V-shaped, it's usually retinal detachment because the apex is located at the optic nerve head. Also note there is abnormal T2 hyperintense signal in the entire aspect of the optic nerve with prominence of the subarachnoid space. This indicates chronic optic neuritis. So we saw retinal detachment. So it's a typical triangular shaped or V-shaped appearance with the apex located at the optic disc. Then the subretinal fluid is showing hyperintense signal on T1 and T2 weighted images suggestive of proteinaceous material or hemorrhage. And you have to differentiate retinal detachment with choroidal detachment. So choroidal detachment is tethered by the vortex veins and hence will not reach up to the optic nerve head. This patient is a 70-year-old male with no vision in the right eye and gradually decreasing vision in the left eye. So what do we see here? We see completely atrophic, disorganized and scarred right globe, which can be because of variety of ocular insults. So this is thyrsus bulbi. Also notice abnormal signal and thinning of the right optic nerve. Now here on the left side, the patient had gradual reduction in the vision. This is because of posterior stephyloma. There is thinning and stretching of the uveoscleral coat along with posterior stephyloma. So this is because of glaucoma, and also note the atrophy of the left optic nerve. This is a 50-year-old male with diminution of vision since 2 months, and the patient attributed that to history of trauma. So what do we see here? We see crescentric shape subretinal exudate. So these are T2 hypointense layering seen in the posterior aspect of the globe. So basically we had done post contrast scans and this does not show enhancement. So these subretinal exudates are commonly seen in uncontrolled hypertensive patients, and usually these are T1 hypo to hyperintense and T2 hypointense. And typically on fundoscopy, you see this cotton wool spots. So this is classic for hypertensive retinopathy. So these are subretinal exudates. Now, coming to the tumors in the adults. So this is the most common tumor, that is choroidal melanoma in the adults. It's the most common primary intraocular tumor. It can arise from choroid, which is seen in 85% of the patients, ciliary body or iris. And how do you diagnose it? Basically, it is a soft tissue mass which is centered on the outer layers of the globe and it projects into the vitreous, so it has a classic mushroom cloud appearance. And as with melanoma, it is hyper intense on T1, hyper intense on T2 weighted images, and it will show intense post contrast enhancement. This is a 52-year-old female with a known carcinoma of breast who presented with headache and blurring of the vision on the right side. So what do we see here? We see an irregular T2 hypointense mass which is seen in the globe in the posterior aspect. So, and it shows minimal enhancement. Along with that, we have the choroidal detachment. So this mass is actually a metastatic lesion. Also, we saw multiple other metastases in the brain. So this is the this indicates the intraocular metastasis along with brain metastasis. I hope you've enjoyed this presentation and you've learned from this presentation. Wait for my next presentation, which will be coming soon. Thank you so much.